Coming up on this episode of The Art of Snooker, we examine the mental component of the game with Joe MacDonald. Sam Cen discusses snooker at the university level. And Kitchener takes on Oshawa at the Ontario Snooker Doubles Championship in Cambridge, Ontario. All that and more on The Art of Snooker.
Welcome back to The Art of Snooker. I am your host, Erica White. Now we are at the Royal Canadian Legion Branch 272 right here in Cambridge, Ontario, where the first annual doubles snooker tournament is taking place. Now people have gathered from all across Ontario to compete for that championship title, but that is not all you'll be seeing today, folks. There will be tips and tricks as well as interviews from experts all related to snooker, so be sure to stay tuned for all of that and more.
We all know that every sport has a physical component to it. Here you have to hit balls, hand-eye coordination, all the other wonderful things that go in it. But wait a minute, there's more to just the physical game. And I have today with me a gentleman who is?
Joe MacDonald.
Joe, you've been in the game quite a while, I understand.
Yes, almost too long.
Almost. Well, I hope you're staying in a lot longer. You've seen all sides of it, as I understand it. You have been a player, and
yes.
Still are.
Yes.
You have been a hall owner. And
yes.
Seen that aspect of it. But you have made a study of why do we do what we do and why can't we do what we want to do?
Absolutely.
And where does that all emanate from at the start?
Well, I think I struggled with that the most in the origins of my game, mm-hmm. that I was always had a conflict of, in practice I could do it relatively simply. And then when it came to doing it in front of television or in tournaments, I had this conflict, and I thought, you know what, I don't have to live like this, and I don't have to play like this. So I, 35 years ago, I said, I'm going to change that, and hopefully I have had some success. I feel like I have had some success. So
the conflict was within yourself.
Yes, it is.
And why was it there? Why couldn't I come to the table and just play the game?
Well, I think... Without getting too deep into it, we come with a certain excitement when we have an interest in something. And as we were talking about before, a lot of the young guys that I teach, they'll come to the game and they're so excited and they're so into it. Mm-hmm. And they get there and they want to learn fast, they want to play fast and everything else like that. And they ask me, how am I doing? And I said, well, you know, I want you to have a certain amount of excitement about the game and about your play. But when you're down on the ball and you're about to stroke, you have to let that dissipate and have a certain calm and a certain space of comfort and quietness to execute what you want to do. Because if you still play with that excitement, as good as it feels, it is a conflict of how you have to execute this game.
So it's a flow through from your mind.
Absolutely.
Saying, I don't care what happened this morning. I don't care what's going to happen tomorrow. I only care that I can control my body and my shot, and that's all I can control.
Absolutely.
Is that it, basically?
And well, how do you arrive at that? Well, that's the ideal. Mm-hmm. But, of course, life we with our mind and our emotion, let's call it psycho-emotion, it isn't compartmentalized. When we're driving here in the traffic, is a little slower, or we get to Tim Hortons and the line's too slow. If we're rolling our eyes and getting upset about all these little things, and the traffic's bugging us and all that, and we're all revved up, then you come here, and a couple of balls go the wrong way. Can you stop yourself from getting upset and rolling your eyes? That takes away from your play. So, part of what I try to help the young players do is if you have an awareness about all you do, all your life, then you can bring it to the table, and it's not foreign to you, and it's not you're not in a conflict, and you don't have to use discipline to stay in your shot. You're just there because there is no conflict or less conflict.
So it's automatic. Your mind then is trained to, I'm now in this environment, Everything else has nothing to do with this.
Absolutely. But every environment should be like that. Don't be in conflict with your environment. And then when you come into this environment, then you have a norm for yourself. But if you're out there and everything is effervescent through irritation and anger and you're rushing, can you come into another room just because you're in another room and be somebody completely different? I say no. Mm-hmm. And then since we've all had a different life experience, a lot of, you know, violent homes, alcoholic homes, all of that, a lot of players like that, of that history, have a very difficult time coming down to this sort of a serene place that they can play at. And then they're most excitable, too, because they're excited about playing and all that, because that sort of emotion that's hidden down there needs an escape. And so they want to learn quick. They want to play fast. They want, and then unfortunately, in this game, it's sort of a dichotomy that you want to be very interested in present while you play, but you can't be too hyperbolic because it takes away from the accuracy and the technique.
Well, I hear a sense of Zen in here, but I'm not going to go there.
Okay. We don't have time.
But the average person who's watching this show, who may or may not know the game, may know it a little bit, mm-hmm. may play it in their basement with their family, may go out socially and playing it, or may compete in their local area, wherever they are, at their local club. How do they become, or should they become aware, that they have to try and bring that to their shot, to their table at some level, make that attempt?
Yeah, I understand. The casual player, that we'll call it, the Saturday night player, They can come to the table, they can have the fun, they can have the drink, have their friends talk and all that. And that's great. They don't have to do anything. But if they find themselves being a little frustrated at what they're doing, then the secret is calm yourself down. As much as you're trying harder, and the harder you try, that's in conflict of what we're really trying to do here.
Okay. So. I guess I'll use this example. The table robbed me. I was robbed of that shot.
Yeah.
The cue must be bent.
Yeah.
Everything.
Lighting's bad.
Everything but saying, I made a mistake.
Taking ownership, sure.
Does that help me in my mental approach to the game?
It absolutely creates more conflict, and you'll set yourself up to fail. Because if you try and try and try at something, inwardly we're like, boy, I'm never going to do this. There might be shame attached to that or whatever. But... And then you're like, oh, it's just too hard. If I can blame it on the table, I'll hurry up and lose.
Joe, I thank you for taking the time today.
It's my pleasure.
To coming in, to showing us that there is much, much more, but you don't have to go there. It depends on the level of involvement that you want to enjoy the game.
Absolutely.
Joe, if people have questions, they can contact Snooker Canada, and we will refer them to you, and perhaps
Beautiful.
You can help out some of
I would
of
love
our...
to help anyone.
Joe, once again, thank you for
thank
your time.
You, Gord.
I've enjoyed it.
My
and
pleasure.
I look forward to many more lessons from you.
Awesome.
I think I need a lot.
Okay.
Thank you.
Don't
Jim.
We all?
Thank you very much.
Coming up after the break, Sam Cen talks about university level snooker.
Welcome to the Art of Snooker.
Thanks so much.
Not only the game, which I understand that you happen to have just recently come from university and played it and represented many of the students. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah.
How it happens at the university level?
So I started the club in first year. I was the president of the Western Billiard Society. And so we don't have any tables on campus. So we do go off campus and bring these students out biweekly. So they can make friends, get to know the sport better.
Mm-hmm. And did you find it successful to achieve those goals?
It was a lot harder just because London is more of a party club scene.
Okay.
And billiards is a little harder to get into because people don't know the sport and they're scared because it's a new thing. Mm-hmm. So then it was a challenge getting people out of their little Western bubble, but it worked in the end a little bit.
Do you think it has a future at university level?
Definitely. Just if you, as snooker and billiards get into the market and more people are aware of it and maybe get some of that like junior teaching out that Snooker Canada is trying to do, we can better penetrate this market and then like bring that awareness out that it's not so scary, not like skydiving, it's just bending over a table and hitting the balls in the pockets.
An analogy of skydiving, sometimes the shots I make, I think I've fallen somewhere. It is a sport that anyone can learn.
Yeah.
And it does teach the hand-eye coordination and the mathematics and geometry and all the other things. Now, it is the third most watched sport in the world. Why doesn't Canada understand it or embrace it?
Well, I feel that we are really connected to the U.S. culture and we're scared of new things. So we stay away from the English where, you know, snooker originated from. And then we stick with our closest neighbor and we take from them.
So we've become Americanized rather than the sport of King of Kings.
Yeah.
Whereas England really started it.
Yeah.
But the rest of the world, India, China, Pakistan, you name it, they have millions of fans.
Yeah.
So you think there is a hope here in Canada?
Definitely.
Now, is it because we're going to start with the youth that it will follow through then?
Yes, I think it is. I think that works the best, just because a lot of the players, the demographic right now is more of people who are retired. They have nothing better to do, so take them to a sport. Whereas our culture, when we're busy, we ignore these like hobbies and stuff like that. So if we start introduce these to the children when they have nothing to do, then they'll bring this care on to the future.
Would it be seen by the students as an intellectual sport versus a contact sport?
Maybe when they get more serious, but initially I think it'll be more of a social sport where you get to meet other people, maybe make some of those friends when you just become a grade 9 or something like that, where a high school will have a snooker table, a pool table, and you can go somewhere where you can expect to meet other people who want to socialize. This is why universities have these clubs systems, just like the club I ran.
So that most students in most universities would be welcoming that type of approach?
Definitely.
Because of what it does, as you just said?
Yeah.
So it's not going to have a stigma attached to it of the old smoky room 40 years ago?
Definitely. The way universities run it, I don't think it'll be stigmatized like that.
Okay. Our demographics, you mentioned, are changing because of the immigrant situation where they're coming from countries that it's just normal to play that sport.
Right.
In China, I understand that you could have 6 snooker halls in a block and they're all busy. You have to wait for a table.
Right.
It's a national sport, so to
speak. Yep.
Which amazes me because North America bubble, we never think of all those things. How did it affect your life in university? Did it increase the social aspect of it, or did you become more of wanting to be better at the game yourself?
So I targeted just the social aspect of it just because of the demographic of London, where it was more social is more important than maybe competitive. Mm-hmm. And then definitely that whole demographic change, that shift, it was way a lot bigger when my predecessors ran it 20 years ago. And then now when I picked it up, it was a lot slower, a lot more casual players instead of competitive players.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I welcome you, by the way, to Snooker Canada's team.
Thank you.
You have been approached and offered a connection to the youth and to the universities to come on to our board and help us work wonders because you understand that level. At 72, I understand Christmas, but I don't understand today's youth. So I welcome you. I hadn't had a chance to publicly acknowledge your coming here, and we hope that good things can happen. Is there anything you'd like to add to university students who may be watching this?
Yeah, sure. Don't be afraid of getting to a new sport, especially since you're young. You're not 72 like Gord. So you can definitely learn many things from pool and other university clubs. So definitely get involved and don't be scared of doing something you haven't started.
Would what they've learned in school, such as geometry, physics, spherical objects, reacting with each other, hand-eye coordination, etiquette, all be of interest that they don't realize that it will help what they've learned?
I think it could be implemented, mm-hmm. but it's more, I've been told that pool is more like a chess game when it gets to
a certain level,
because you're trying to position balls in certain places and thinking about what that person's going to do. So geometry, physics, stuff like that is really hard to apply, but definitely it is there. Mm-hmm. And I guess it could help in some way, but if you don't know it, it's not going to hurt you.
It help you develop your physical game.
Yeah.
And it make it more natural because you've been thinking of angles through school. You've been now putting it into play.
Yeah.
And it frees you up from that lag towards the game that it became cerebral, and it does become a chess match.
Right.
Very much so. Sam, thank you for taking the time to come on the show.
Thank you.
And we look forward to working with you, those of us in Snooker Canada.
Uh-huh.
And I also congratulate you on a new job.
Thank you.
And we'll talk again soon.
Okay.
Thanks, Sam.
Thanks a lot. Very much.
Coming up after the break, it's Team Kitchener versus Team Oshawa at the Ontario Snooker Doubles Championship. Welcome back to the Art of Snooker. We're heading to the main table at the Royal Canadian Legion Branch 272, where Kitchener and Oshawa are set to square off. With the call, here's David Burney.
Hello there, and welcome everyone to another exciting game of snooker. Today we have a six-ball match between the team from Kitchener that is made up of Jared Morrison, who is going to break off right now. His teammate is Jerry Phillips. And they're facing a team from Oshawa that's made up of Derek Claus and Phil Snake. And for all you that are following Canadian snooker, you might know Phil Snake from making the finals at the Richler Cup back in Montreal. So we're glad to see a familiar face at the table, and hopefully he can do well today. And we're underway here from Cambridge, Ontario, Canada. And Derek's at the table. It's tough with these six reds because any little mistake could be costly. It's a good solid pot there by Jerry.
One.
Jerry doesn't seem to waste any time, just gets down on the shot, gets on to business. Now you had the option there of running around the table or just slowly roll through, which he did, because there is this red that's open to the left corner pocket. Good shot there of Phil's form. Oh, he could have done without that double kiss, but I think he's got lucky as we...
Loop.
And he's selecting for the blue. And drained it. Good shot there by Jerry. Oh, that was a very nice shot, too. It was snug against the top of the bulk cushion there. Nope, just electing to play safe. Nice shot by Phil. It's a good shot at the concentration. Good pot.
So what?
Ooh.
One.
Well, hopefully Derek can rebound for his partner's mishap. Obviously, a lot of these guys aren't used to having the TV cameras around, so there's just that added little pressure when you're thinking about the shot. Getting some great shots by our camera team here. Dynamite job they've done. Yeah, that
nine.
the thing with this six red format, is you're never really out of the game, and all the games usually come 14? Down to when we're into the colors. That's a lovely shot. Well struck. 16? Run a little bit. I think he'll be okay.
19.
Still good break there for Derek to get his team back in the game. Well struck. The other side of this game, it's not just all about potting balls, there's a tactical approach at it. As the match goes on, they'll get used to it. Oh, that was an excellent 11 pot.
And the frame.
This long pot is a tough one, but that will get Kitchener the first frame of this match. Out there by Jerry. He had was snookered. Phil supporting a nice new haircut. And sharp as always. Great pot there. He's a really great rest player. Oh, maybe this cuts through. Oh, no. I think the black will come back in the corner pocket that he's over top of. Nice shot.
One.
That was a good risky shot, and the reward is going to be helpful for him. Because there are those two reds that are by the pink, that if he missed it, it could be on for his opponent. Good safety shot.
It scored.
Well up, and I think he's frozen himself on that red. That would be the first contact for the red. Nice shot by Phil. Quick, and then when he gets down. Oh, he's gone for the black. Surprised me. And made a beautiful shot on it. Great shot to get onto this red into the green pocket. This is kind of what Phil needs. Phil's a good player. Just get a feel for the ball. Nine. And once he gets a good break on, and then he can get his rhythm going. And he's really a strong player. Not really a slow player, too. He knows what needs to happen. He gets down to it. And he doesn't dilly-dally a lot. If he knows what he needs 13. To do, he gets down to business and takes care of it. That's what you do. Yeah. Phil is an aggressive player, but just didn't get the break that he wanted in there.
17.
What? That's a nice little hook there.
That Team Oshawa, 17.
He's definitely now got the feel for the table, but 35 points on the 26. Table. And they're just up by 26, so still anybody's frame. Oh, just one cushion. Yep, just playing it safe. Ooh. Oh, just electing to play safe. Oh, and that was the problem of taking it on. Very nicely stroke. Ooh. missed it, and he's missed it badly. He's left it over the pocket. The team from Kitchener does need a snooker to force a black respot. Use a little bit of gusto on that. Brilliant shot there by Derek.
Four.
Now I really don't think that Kitchener is going to come back to the table.
Nine scored and the frame.
And Kitchener has conceded that frame, so Oshawa has tied it up 1-1 here in frame two. Made a nice break off there. I don't think there's much there. And a brilliant shot there. Just great pace to be onto the black. Oh!
Team Oshawa, one. Sorry, team.
You can't believe it.
Kitchen. One.
When you get these opportunities, this is where you have to punish your opponent. Now, I do believe. In this game, when Jared missed that, there's about a 10-second rule. If it doesn't go in within 10 seconds, then they got to play on. Mm-hmm. This is looking good for Phil. Ooh.
16 scored.
Jared electing to play safe. No real sure shot on. So a little bit of thinking needing to happen with the shot. Does he want to take it on, or does he want to just play safe? As you can see, but I think you got lucky with that, but it is a long pot. Lucky not to take it and just play safe. Oh, what's this, a double? Very what? Nicely done there by Jerry. Good eye on that. Now it's Oshawa's turn. Or, I'm sorry, my apologies, Kitchener's turn. To get back into the game.
Eight.
And he's played that nicely. That little kiss on that red was nice. Just to deaden the red, so he's got a nice angle on this red to tuck it in to the side.
Nine.
Yeah, I just want to stun into this little stun drawback maybe onto this brown. Because that red definitely goes in the side. Yep, didn't need the cue ball to move around too much. He's got good control of that cue ball. It's the black ball we got to worry 14, about sometimes. 30. Just missing that little shot previously, but this run, this break that he's having is making up for it.
Fourteen.
just one subtle miss and your opponent can come to the table and really punish you. Ooh. It's when he was feathering over a ball.
Two.
He'd say, yellow, yellow, yellow. And then as soon as he came to the ball, he'd say his object ball, because he didn't want to risk a foul when he was feathering of hitting that ball. So he wasn't fully Chinese snookered there. And a great shot by Phil. That's a nice pot there.
Five.
Ooh. The pink isn't on the spot, but it is out in the open, so it's not too difficult. Should get some bottom on this just so he doesn't get the in off. But obviously putting the bottom makes it a little difficulter of a shot.
Nine.
Oh, a wonderful shot there.
15.
I think it's going to seal the deal.
I don't think you need it either. Okay, that's a frame.
And Oshawa has conceded. So Kitchener takes this important third frame to lead 2-1, needing one frame to take the match. One frame to go to win. Part is where the pink is going to be respotted. But he does have that red by the green pocket. Oh, Derek just electing to play safe. Don't want to risk too much when you're down by one frame. It definitely crawls into your thinking. We're going to start to get in a little bit of tactical play here. A few safeties back and forth. Ooh. Didn't run into that red. Very nice shot. Now, there's a few difficult reds for Derek here. Obviously, the one on the top cushion and the one on the side rail over there, the side cushion. But hit that well. So
maybe the nine.
So he's taking that one red out of the equation. It's on a cushion.
16.
Does it effectively.
17.
Oh.
Ooh. Paul.
Such team a great run.
17.
Great. Oh, look at that. He wasn't really hampered by that jaw. Made a good effort at it. Oh, this could be nice. This could be real nice. So, able to see this red, he's also able to possibly cut it into that corner pocket, which he does excellently. His partner,
one.
Jared, likes it, and so does Derek. Both applaud in a good shot. Nice black there. Good pace on that shot. Always nice using your own tip. You know it through and through. As we can see, he pots that ball nicely. Perfectly played. Both teams great with the rest.
18.
To force a decider. Oh my. But Phil didn't make him pay. He does nicely. Three. Very nice shot. It's a nice angle, that shot. That's a great shot, too, right there. Alrighty, you gotta use the rest.
12 short.
Very hot six. There. Phil could have ran through that a bit more. Where's this white going? Look out. Oh! Wow.
7 away.
And that will have done it. Handshakes are had. A good effort by Oshawa. But Kitchener's victorious in this match. They took it 3-1. And they'll be moving on.
Up next, a conversation with snooker player George Perry.
George Perry is a snooker gypsy. I can only phrase it that way. How do you attend these events and why do you do it that way?
Well, I attend the events in my little motorhome that I travel around in, and the reason I do is because when I come to these events, sometimes I'm far away from the event as far as the hotel is concerned, and I like to be mobile. I like to get around and, you know, just take care of myself, and so I just feel much more at home in my motorhome.
Does it help you being better rested for the tournaments each day?
Absolutely. I get up three hours at least, and I'll have something to eat, and I'll shower up, wash up, and you know, just have a little mental thing, and I'm ready to go.
Do you know anybody else on the tour or circuit that does that?
The last I heard was Bill Werbeneck from Winnipeg.
Well, the name Werbeneck certainly went down in Canadian history with snooker.
Yeah.
You think we can start a trend so you guys can all do caravans to the various events?
Well, you know, we're starting to revive it back in Windsor, and I'm hoping that some of the guys, as a matter of fact, they do as well. I have one or two guys that usually travel with me.
Well, we're going to give you a plug. Even though this isn't airing until the beginning of the new year, and we're taping it just before that, you have a bit of an announcement that you guys have been working on down in Windsor.
Yes, we're opening up a new snooker hall called the Erie Billiards right downtown Windsor in front of the Casino Windsor. You got the Renaissance for a nice view of the river, and we're looking forward to bringing a little more snooker back to Windsor.
Is this because there was a lack of places to play in?
There hasn't been snooker there in over 10 years, and we used to have a tremendous representation in Windsor, going back a long ways, and you know, we're due. We're ready to come back into the fold and show where Windsor's at.
How many tables do you have?
Well, we have four Westbury, BC Westburys, and we have six coin-op tables, Valley, and then we have 2 4.5 by 9. Brunswick Crowns.
So you're covering most of the sport, snooker, baseball,
yes,
et cetera.
We'll be holding events for both pool, yes.
Very good. Now, I know this will have already been happened some when our audience is listening to this. So you've developed a name of a room there that seems to have a special designation.
Yes, it's called the Green Room. And like I said, Windsor hasn't had snooker in about 10 years, so with my wife's help, I opened up a little private club aside my house. I called it the Green Room, and I've been running the Windsor Snooker League for 10 years now. And I've got actually three leagues, mixed doubles league, and I'm getting a lot of ladies involved, and we're going to be bringing them to the club.
You're getting a lot of ladies involved with your wife's permission. I like that. Absolutely. I need to take some lessons here.
Well, you know what? I have a sister, and she loves the game, and as soon as she saw what I was doing, she asked me if she could do the same thing, and I just said, pick a day, and it's yours.
Very nice. Very, very good. What made you, or how did you pull all this together? On your own, or are there others involved?
The pool room itself?
Yeah.
Well, like I said, I've been having the league up at my place for over 10 years, and throughout this 10 years, like I say, I've had three leagues, a top mm-hmm. A league for the players. And throughout the years, you know, the guys just, we were all just talking, and we decided, you know, it's time we expand and get more people involved, because we had a lot of people there, and we know that we can do a lot better than that.
Are there any people involved in it that are on the tour for the Richler Cup that are playing events?
Yes, there is. There's four of us, including myself.
And they are?
Frank Mancini, Gary Warren, and John Finazzo.
Thank you, because I've met them and seen them play, and I'm glad and congratulate you on the effort that you've done. Well, hopefully Snooker Canada was able to help you a little bit.
Absolutely.
And anyone thinking of opening a hall, you obviously now have the ability to guide them a little bit, and hopefully refer them to Snooker Canada, and we'll help them along as well.
Yeah, and hopefully we're looking forward to having Snooker Canada in Windsor again.
We'll be there, one way or the other, by hook or by crook. How long have you been playing?
Well, I've been playing over 50 years, 52 years, probably, to be exact.
Has your game changed a great deal?
Yeah, I've actually got better.
That is the same. You know we get better with age,
you
right?
You know what? There's no limit, really. I mean, you know, you can. It's just amazing that no matter how old you go, you know what? You can still get better.
And you can still play the game.
I can still play the game.
Well, I've seen people in wheelchairs. I've seen people with all sorts of disabilities play the game and play it well. And I've seen older guys like myself, not necessarily you, find out that, yeah, we can improve. And we can play the game until we're in 90s. I used to play a guy in Brantford. He was 92. I couldn't beat him.
I believe it. I believe it. You know what?
Just had the skill.
And the desire. That's all you need.
The desire. Very, very much so. Have you enjoyed this tournament, the format of six reds?
I really enjoyed it. I've met a lot of nice people throughout the way and you know, I got to play to the finals, so I'm really happy with the way things turned out.
Do you think the six-ball format is acceptable for the players?
I really do, because, you know, there was a lot of players here, and, you know, we're constricted with time, and I think it went along good, and, you know, I don't know what more reds would do to enhance it. I think it was fine.
Because I think our audience is looking for a little more action from snooker. I mean, the game can take a long time with 15 reds, and it gets kind of boring watching it.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what, though. You know, one of the reasons six reds, you're playing partners, too. You know, so one guy's sitting down. He doesn't shoot till two shots later or three shots later. You know, when you're playing singles, 15 reds, so absolutely. But, you know, I don't know if it's going to, four guys playing, go ahead and add reds. I don't know if it's going to really enhance the...
What happens if there were just two people playing and it was still six reds?
Then you'd probably be seeing more runouts.
A little more action for the audience?
Yes.
A little more interest?
A little more interest.
And that's why we're trying to do is raise the profile and bring it back to what it was 20 years ago in Canada. The people like yourself opening halls, joining in events, traveling around... we need to put a sign on your, maybe do some advertising on your vehicle.
I've got ideas, but I don't think I'm going to mention it now until I talk to my wife.
You also have wisdom as we get older. Very good. Thank you for taking the time. I sincerely appreciate it. I congratulate you on making it as far as you did and enjoying the time. You seem to be able to match the skill and involvement with a social sport, a hobby.
Well, I like people, so.
It shows. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Take care.
Coming up next, we're running the colors on the Art of Snooker.
Go!
That was another episode of The Art of Snooker. I'm your host, Erica White. Thank you so much for tuning in. Be sure to check us again next week as we continue on The Art of Snooker.
Coming up on the next episode of The Art of Snooker, we look at the art of crafting a snooker table. Jim Jack demonstrates how to maintain your table, and Toronto faces Scarborough at the Ontario Snooker Doubles Championship.